MedCram.com.
Welcome to our talk on ventilator-associated pneumonia. We're going to get started with looking over some of the objectives that we're going to cover in this lecture series. So the first objective is that we're going to identify, or ID, the epidemiology, the pathophysiology, detection, and the risk factors for VAP. Number two is we're going to identify the risk reduction strategies. And number three, we're going to identify the pitfalls of implementation. And then finally, for number four, we're going to identify the areas of controversy. So there is controversy because this is a burgeoning field in terms of research. Okay, the first thing that we really want to attack is the definition of VAP. And really, what is the definition of VAP, or ventilator-associated pneumonia? Basically, it's a pneumonia that arises more than 48 to 72 hours after endotracheal tube intubation, okay? So you really can't make this diagnosis on admission unless the patient's coming from another facility where they were intubated more than 48 to 72 hours before. So in terms of this, it's just simply looking up at the time when the patient was intubated. So the timeline is pretty easy. The part that's difficult is figuring out the pneumonia portion. So what exactly is a pneumonia? Now, typically when we think about pneumonia, we think of a fever, we think of an increased WBC count, and we think of an infiltrate. So you really should have an x-ray. That's the cornerstone of diagnosis of pneumonia. The problem is that some people may not get a fever, and other people may be on immunosuppressants, or they may have a low white blood cell count. And then sometimes, if they don't have an immune system that is functional, they may not even have an infiltrate. Or, what's even more common, is other things may cause abnormalities on the chest x-ray that have nothing to do with an infection or a pneumonia. And so really what the problem is in terms of definition is not the timing, but is what is exactly a pneumonia. And as a result of that, there's been kind of two strategies that have looked at this definitional issue. One is known as the clinical strategy, and the other is known as the bacteriologic. Okay, so here we have the non-invasive, and this would be more as the invasive. Okay, so what do these things mean? And we're going to get back to these two strategies, the clinical and the bacteriologic. Just be aware that there is sufficient not being quite clear about how you define this pneumonia. And so there's been two strategies in the literature. The clinical, which where you look at things clinically and make a determination based on some criteria, or the bacteriological, which is the invasive, typically involving tracheal aspirates. So where they put a tube down the tube and get a tracheal aspirate and then culture it and see how many bacterial counts they have. Okay, so we're going to get back to that. But first of all, let's go through our objectives and let's talk about the epidemiology. So in terms of epidemiology, the literature is about 10 to 20% of patients on mechanical ventilation. So that's about 6 to 21 times the risk of contracting pneumonia. Okay, so that's the prevalence. Now, in terms of mortality, this can range anywhere from 13% to 55%, depending on the literature that you look at. The attributable mortality, which means, you know, how much can we say that the VAP was actually the reason for the patient passing away, is about 30%. I don't think you need to know these numbers specifically, but I would say that this is a serious issue, and that's why we're taking it very seriously. Not only in terms of death and life, but in terms of financially, the length of stay in the hospital increases by about 9 days. So that's an increase of about 62%. 62% increase. What does that translate into in terms of dollars? That's about $40,000 per patient. So if we can prevent ventilator-associated pneumonia, you can see that we can prevent a lot of bad things from happening. let's talk about how it actually happens. Okay, so here is a drawing of a larynx and trachea and bronchi with lungs. And what I want to show you is the endotracheal tube. So as you know, in intubation, the endotracheal tube goes down about 2 to 3 centimeters above the carina, up to about 5. And as you know, there's a balloon that gets inflated to prevent secretions from going down below into the lungs. Of course, it's not 100%. But the pathophysiology is that there's aspiration of these oral pharyngeal pathogens, of gram negatives, etc., or leakage of these secretions containing the bacteria, which are up here in the oral pharynx. And what happens is they go down here, and there's pooled secretions which sit above this balloon and drip down into the lungs. And this goes into the lower respiratory tract. Now, a lot of the pathophysiology and the epidemiology has come out of the latest guidelines from the Infectious Disease Society of America and the American Thoracic Society, which were published back in 2005, and it sort of was a definitive paper. So if you want to do further reading, please go to the American Journal of Respiratory and Critical Care Medicine 2005 and look up the IDSA and ATS guidelines. Everything that they say, they give evidence for. There's level 1 evidence, which is the highest, level 2, which is intermediate, and then level 3, which is less. And the evidence for which they say this is the cause of the pathophysiology is level 2 evidence. So pretty good, but not randomized placebo-controlled, obviously. The other thing that they mention is that because this is a non-living item here inside the patient, biofilm can form on top of this, and it can be very difficult to eradicate. So this is not foolproof here. The balloon is inflated, but you can't overinflate it. And what you'll get is secretions which go down, and that causes the VAP. And so you can see that a lot of the treatments that we'll talk about later or prevention strategies are going to prevent this mode of transmission and causation of VAP. So now that we've talked about the epidemiology, the prevalence, the pathophysiology, let's go back to what we were talking about before, which was the actual diagnosis or the detection of VAP and our dichotomy between the clinical non-invasive and the bacteriological or the invasive. So let's talk about the clinical. The clinical strategy is quite simple. What you really need is something that has happened to the patient after 48 to 72 hours of intubation. And those things would be a new infiltrate. But several things could cause a new infiltrate, and the way to make sure it's a pneumonia is by checking for a fever and an elevated WBC count. But a lot of things can cause that as well, as we mentioned, so you also should look for purulent sputum. If these things occur, there's a good chance that you're going to pick up a ventilator-associated pneumonia. So a pneumonia that the patient got while they were on the ventilator. Remember, it has to happen 48 to 72 hours after intubation. But there's a chance that you could get a pneumonia, and it may not cause an infiltrate, it may not cause a fever, may not cause an elevated white count, and the patient may not have purulent sputum. So in other words, what you may have here are some false negatives. Okay, so this is going to be very specific, but you may lose some more subtle types of VAP. Now, in contrast, let's go over to the bacteriological. Here we use bronchoscopy that goes actually down into the lungs and samples. You could also use tracheal aspirates, but classically it's bronchoscopy. We actually sample secretions that are down in the lungs, and typically those should be sterile, or certainly below a threshold. Now, you know that if I were to culture your skin, I would get bacteria, but your skin is not infected and you don't have cellulitis. But in people who do have cellulitis, the bacterial counts are much higher on the skin, indicating that there is an infection. And so what you could do is do a bronchoscopy and culture and set a certain threshold, like 10 to the 3, in terms of colony-forming units, and that would determine whether or not there was colonization or whether or not there is infection. Okay, so the risk here is that you may have enough bacteria causing colonization, and you may call it a positive when in fact it would be a false positive. So here the risk is false positive rate, and you can see how it would be very sensitive. And there's pros and cons on this on both sides. Now, the thing is that there's some downsides to the bacteriological. If you've changed antibiotics within the last 24 hours, typically it's going to depress the colonization rate, and you may actually get a false negative in that sense. There is some evidence on the upside using this technique that if you don't see bacteria, then you could stop antibiotics. And there's actually was a study that showed that after 2 weeks, mortality rates actually dropped. Also, if you had a negative colony-forming unit threshold, in other words, if you did the threshold and it was low, it was below your threshold, then you could say that the infection might be coming from another source. Maybe it's actually not from the lungs. And that would spur you on to look for sources elsewhere and actually could benefit the patient. I think in terms of what you should choose, and certainly the IDSA guidelines say you could use either one. Both are appropriate. Both are standard of care. One has more advantages than the other. Obviously, if you don't have somebody doing bronchoscopy, then the bacteriological strategy is going to be something that you can't do. The clinical can be done fairly cheaply, and it can be done just about anywhere. So there are advantages and disadvantages with either. The key that I would say is that if you're going to track ventilator-associated pneumonia rates in your hospital, you ought to stick with one definition and use it consistently, because how you define VAP can change your prevalence and your incidence of VAP. I'll just say that there are a number of algorithms out there of the diagnosis of ventilator-associated pneumonia. Some of them are related to VAP in immunocompromised patients, and some of them are related to VAP in immunocompetent patients. And so make sure that you look it up, make sure that you make a protocol and you stick with it. That's, I think, the key, because you really want to make sure that you don't have a moving target. You want to make sure that you're consistent in terms of your definition. Okay, well, join us for our next video when we get into the risk factors for VAP.